John Cullen with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. We're here in Super Seth's backyard, cannabis and vegetable grow, primarily in his raised beds for the fifth update. Links down below to all the previous episodes. I was here literally in May when he planted these two girls here. We got the full gas and the purple ghost candy. They were like this big, and just 3.5 months later, these girls are amazing. Check out how big they are. So we're gonna go ahead and give you guys the update. Now it is currently about the middle of August, although this video will air later since I'm behind in editing and getting videos out for you guys. So we're gonna give you guys an update on what has been grown here at Super Seth. So in some of the other videos you guys saw his whole raised beds. So I wanted to give you guys an overview shot and kind of go over what we're gonna go over today. You can see we got the berries over there. The raspberries are pumping out. And I'm gonna show you guys the difference that the amendments and techniques that Seth uses makes to the crops. Cause it's like, okay, yeah, put all this stuff in. What's the benefit, John? I've seen Seth do all these crazy things, make this fermented plant juice, FPJ in the last video. He does the compost tea, feeds that stuff out, uses all the boogie products. He buys all those organic amendments from Amazon, Build a Soil, and everywhere else in the world. What difference does it make? And that's really what I want to show you guys, the small differences it makes, plus as well as some of his other tips that he uses to get the growth that he does. But I think this is amazing where he has the cannabis, you know, next to his squashes, his cucumbers vining out, more squashes, and then he's got tomato trellised like in with the cannabis. And actually that's something special I want to show you guys, because I know about tomatoes. Seth may know more about cannabis than I do, but I know about tomatoes. And of course his best cannabis plant that's currently in flower. So I guess first I want to show you guys the update on the trellis tomatoes. So we've got the cannabis here, but then right behind we got the tomato plant. Look at this, guys. This is just one plant right here. And look at all the tomatoes on this one vine, right? I bet none of you guys have tomatoes that have this many tomatoes on one vine. I mean, usually when I get a vine like this on a sweet million, I might have like maybe 10. I mean, there's like way more than 10. Look at this. Here's another vine. And this is not just one vine, guys. This is not an isolated incident, right? And I mean, that's not even that crazy on this super sweet million. We could go over here. This is a sun goal. And I know a lot of you guys love sun goals like me. But look at this, this is one branch of sun gold. All the tomatoes here, all the tomatoes here, all the tomatoes here. How many of you guys have ever seen this on like one, this is like a whole hand. This is a whole hand of tomatoes, right? When a plant is super happy, it super reproduces, right? And make lots of fruit. So I don't care if you guys are growing, you know, tomatoes, cucumbers, squash, or cannabis flowers, right? The more nutritious the soil, the happier the plants, the happier the rhizosphere, the happier the soil, the more earthworms in your soil, the more fruit and flower production you're gonna get. And that's why Seth does all these crazy things. So even if you don't do all these crazy things that Seth does, right, just do a few more, add a few more that you like the most, that makes the most sense to you. And then guess what? You may have tomatoes that grow this many tomatoes, or you may have cannabis plants that have lots more flowers. And besides just the quantity, right, it's also about the quality. Let's go ahead and taste test a Sweet Million's ripe tomato today. All right, so first up, we're gonna try a Sweet Million. Here, I've been eating tomatoes out of my garden, actually, the last few days. So a Sweet Million grown by Seth, nice ripe one. Mmm. Tastes a little bit flat, tastes a little bit watery to me. Maybe he's overwatering these. All right, next up, we're gonna go ahead and try a sun gold here. Try to find a ripe one. I've been eating a lot of these in my garden because I grew these this year. I gotta say, that's a good sun gold. I'd say comparable to mine, but what is not comparable to mine is that actually he has a lot more fruit than I got on every single branch. So we're gonna go ahead and give you guys some tomato porn right now. Look at this. I mean, this is a Sweet Million. Once again, just one branch, all these fruits. And if you just look up in here, there's just tons of little cherry tomatoes like all over. Here's like a Berkeley tie-dye plant, right? Okay, there's a bunch here. There's a bunch here, and these aren't necessarily a cherry, so they're not gonna have as many. But look, this plant is still loaded up with tons of fruit, right? One branch, guys. purple tie-dye Berkeley tomatoes.
All right, now I'm gonna show you guys another fruit that I'm growing myself, actually not too far away from here. And he's got his raspberries, and these raspberries are pumping out, guys. I mean, my raspberries are kind of under shade, not in the best location, but I basically don't do anything to grow them. And you guys can see his raspberries are just pumping with all this ripe fruit, easy to pluck. And I want to encourage you guys, I know a lot of you guys eat raspberries, but you don't grow them or you don't eat other berries. But look at this, man. I could just like pluck off a whole bunch. I have a nice handful already to eat. I gotta say, Seth's raspberries taste better than mine. And he's got a lot more production. Like, look at all these flowers, guys. Some of these were previously harvested. But this is really, you could have less plants, do more amendments, and have more fruit instead of growing like more plants with less fruit. You guys got that? So yeah, that's why you want to take care of your soil, and it and the plants will take care of you. So now I want to share with you guys how you could tell if your cannabis plant is happy. I mean, it may have some flowers on there, but it's not going to be like tomatoes where you can see tons of fruits on there. But what I want to show you guys is actually when your cannabis plant is happy, and actually, matter of fact, many plants are happy, they're going to have praying leaves. You ever see like a monk pray? He's like praying to the god, right? But that's what you want the leaves on your cannabis plant, right, to do. See how they're kind of like oriented up and open like this? They're praying to the sun, so that the plant could get the sun. If they're like really far down and the leaves are like more flattened out or even drooping, right, that's when they're sad. But this is when they are fully happy. So you always want to have praying leaves. Now the praying leaves, besides what you're gonna add to the soil, besides how you're watering it, you know, also depends on the plant genetics as well as the weather. I will say that not every plant that Seth is growing has a praying leaves, but the overwhelmingly majority of them do, except in some rare instances when he's not matching the soil with the genetics, with the weather, and other environmental factors that may be out of his control. All right, so I want to give you guys another update on some pretty impressive growth to me, because actually this exact plant I gave to Seth, actually I bought cuttings at the farmer's market, took them home myself, and I grew them, and then Seth just stuck them in the ground and watered, and they rooted. And I've been growing these same exact plants, so it's very interesting to see the difference in growth between Seth's plants and my plants. So how I grow is I just basically rooted them in water for a few weeks. They rooted, then I stuck them in my ground. My irrigation comes on every day, and I maybe did some foliar feeds, but I didn't have time to do compost tea this year, so I've been naughty. And my plants are growing nice and large, so they're like growing a lot more. My leaves are a lot bigger, but the spacing in between the nodes are a lot longer, because actually I just did cuttings off some more yesterday or 2 days ago. And on Seth's plants, like his plants are actually shooting up new growth where mine are not shooting up as this much new growth. And also his nodes are super tight and super close together compared to mine. Like the nodes on his plants are like this wide and my nodes are like about like that. So it's very interesting now that we do have a little bit different weather patterns where these are being grown as well. But this is a lot more new upshooting. So for me, if these were my plants, I'd probably just top them all. And then I'd have like a nice bunch of greens like to eat for a salad. Whereas if I do that on mine, I'm concerned because they don't grow quite as fast. Like his, if you do that, it's going to pop up new growth and then just shoot out new growth. On mine, I pop leaves off because I have a lot more leaf material that just grows a lot faster. And I've been trellising them up, and I think my longest one is maybe like 10 feet long vine now, and his are basically only like maybe like not even quite a foot tall yet. So it's quite interesting to see the difference. But you know, this is when your plant is happy. It's gonna be nice and bushy, and that's what we want. We want bushy, not lanky plants like Seth's growing. All right, so I'm under the canopy here. He has two plants and actually kind of keeps some air space between them. So it's like on fruit trees, you have like two fruit trees, one hole. And these aren't exactly the same hole, but Seth is basically growing it so that it looks like one plant, but they're two separate plants. But anyways, I want to give you guys an update on the super cropping. Link down below to the second episode we did at Seth's where we explained the super cropping technique. But this is how it totally works out, and this is why he does it, because now that the plants are in flower, you could see the benefit. All right, so if we do a close-up, this is the main leader branch going up right here, and then it goes up, and this should continue straight up. But he totally bent it, and I mean, almost goes at a right angle, goes up and then bends over.
And then as it bends over, it then once again goes up to the sky, and it basically just fills in and creates the, you know, canopy nicely. Instead of like being straight up, it wouldn't get as much sun, but it's like totally grown out.
And here's another excellent example right here. You guys can see once again, this is the main growth stem. It would have grew straight up in the canopy there, but instead he'd be like, this is basically a right angle bend right here. And then it grows out, and then he bent it again right there, which is actually totally stable, and then it's growing out. And then this is what you really want. You see how the new growth is now just basically going straight up. So, I mean, otherwise this would have been way over here, filling in, competing for light, whereas now it's just over in its own plane where there's no competition for the light, because he's like did some two major super cropping bends, you know, there and there, which is totally insane. And then of course, any kind of bends like this, the plant is not necessarily designed to, you know, go that direction. If it's going straight up, it's kind of like strong. But so then he had to like stake it up, and he kind of like reinforced it. Here's another reinforcement. He uses the little ties there to kind of like hold this a little bit to give it some more strength when you are super cropping this extreme. So yeah, let's call this a extreme super cropping.
I want to give you guys the update on the peyote Skittles that's growing in between the two tomatoes he has trellis. So you can see the tomatoes over on this side growing up the trellis, and he wanted to keep these cannabis plants, which is basically about a half and half THC CBD mix approximately, in between them. So basically he put this trellis netting, which is like you get on Amazon for like, I don't know, $5 or $10, super cheap. And he just put it in there to train his plants up so that if they should get too heavy, they won't like lean and break. Plus you can kind of keep them growing inwards instead of out, you know, into the tomatoes. And it looks like it's working really well. Now I want to give you guys another update on his cannabis. And this is like from like last season, last year. You know, here's his full gas, which you guys saw in the opening shot. But what he does a full no-till method. So like this is his old stump of the cannabis from last year. So he cut it down here, he planted the new one here. And actually this year's stump is a lot fatter. It's a big fatty compared to the old stump. Of course, you know, the variety and the genetics and the weather is going to differ as well. But, you know, I think that I want you guys, whether it's your vegetables or your cannabis plants, this is what I do also. I don't pull the stumps out. I just leave them in the ground to rot, to feed the soil microbes, feed the earthworms in there. When you guys do that, the earthworms are breaking down the old organic matter, the bacteria, fungi, and different creatures in the soil are breaking down the organic matter and making more fertilizer right where you need it, instead of making a compost pile and then you having to bring it over. So this is a very important technique. And I know, especially if you're in, you know, hydroponic growing, like you guys don't even use your soil again, where it says growing in the same soil year after year, even with his old roots rotting, decaying, and composting in the ground right next to his new growth without any problems. All right, speaking about compost, let's talk about the update on Super Seth's compost pile. So that cheap plastic bin he had from Amazon that he liked so much, he was in there working on it, and then he hit it, and then it all of a sudden it just broke. So he got rid of it. So don't even buy it. I think we showed that in the first episode, had lots of worms in there. So he basically converted his systems into using the fencing material, you know, metal fencing material. He also has a big fabric pot on the bottom just to kind of keep everything contained. He still has his Brown's pile where he collects his leaves and other materials. And he has two piles, which are low turn piles. A lot of you guys flip your compost, didn't turn a lot, but actually for better fungal activity, you want to minimally turn it. So all these piles are turned only a maximum of 3 times by Seth. You know, he starts the composting over there, he puts this in here, and then he'll like flip it once or twice between them. And then that's done, it's it. And I wanna show you guys how this is working so you guys can see around the edges, he has all the browns. And then down the middle cone, he basically layers browns and greens. So the nitrogen and the carbon layers. And this is, right now it's about 100 degrees. And the weather here right now is actually mid 70s today on this summer day. So yeah, nice and warm. And now we're gonna show you guys how he feeds his compost pile, which is not rocket science. He takes his food scraps, which you got some apple cores and different things on there.
spread down the middle. Got some citrus peels. And then things like his wife's roses and flowers that he bought her because he's a good husband. Basically just gets thrown on the compost pile also. And then finally he shreds up all his cardboard boxes from his Amazon purchases. And he dumps it on top. Covers it up. And don't leave your thermometer in there. I mean, that's all it is, guys. Composting is super simple. I want you guys to, you know, use your food scraps, excess flowers. You're hopefully buying your wife, or your wife's buying you, equal rights in this day and age. And compost it so that you're not sending it to the landfill and you're making some delicious nutrients for your soil, microbes, and your plants in the upcoming season. All right, I want to give you guys an update on the red hot cookies. This is already well into flower here and actually really has a nice smell to it. If I smell them, but one of the reasons why it smells good and is looking good is because the soil, it is all about the soil, guys. I want you guys to focus on the soil. Make love to your soil is what Josh from Boogie Brew says. And that's what Seth is doing here. So how is Seth making love to soil? Well, it's two ways. Number one, he's throwing down just all the different leaves. So he's doing some light mulching on the top of the soil. He's also keeping the soil alive by planting in vegetables underneath his cannabis to kind of keep the soil microbes active. And this is what happens when you have really happy soil. You could just pull this aside and look at this. I just did some random spot. Worm, 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 worm. They're all moving all over. All the worms are right underneath, literally at the top of the soil, and they're feeding and they're pooping and making the worm castings and making a really nutritious soil with all the biologic activity your plants need to be happy. So what is the result of having healthy soil? Well, it's having healthy plants. So now we're gonna go ahead and show you guys my opinions on the best way to use your buds that you're growing. So I personally don't believe you should be smoking all your bud, or actually any bud, because I don't smoke any bud myself. I prefer to eat it, right? So we're gonna go here, popcorn bud, inner side, not gonna get any sun. Nothing's ever gonna happen to it. And I want you guys, you know, if you guys have little small popcorn buds, buds you're trimming out because they're just on the inner leaves inside of the plant, I want you guys to take them and first smell it like you would smell a good wine. And this, man, this is so terpy, guys. I mean, this is getting a little bit sticky right here. I'm feeling the stick. Smells so good. And I want you guys to eat your buds or drop these into a smoothie. Make a blended smoothie out of them, right? I want you guys to get the raw cannabinoids into you, the THCA, the CBDA. Excellent way. And when you eat them raw, just like this, fresh harvested, you won't get any psychoactive or intoxicating effects because you're not decarbing it. Man, this bud, it's nice. I want to say watery, but it's like I wouldn't say wet, but I would say it's really full of like liquid. It's like liquid hydration. It's not like eating a fruit. And a lot of leaves I eat are kind of dry, but there's a lot of nice water content in here. To me, this tastes like really good. And this is probably one of the best buds I've ever eaten. And I'm even sure, hopefully Seth eats a few more of them than he ends up smoking. So now we're here with Super Seth, and we're gonna be cover cropping, because that's one of the things he likes to do. Is once again, for soil health, you wanna cover your soil, whether with mulch, or more importantly, living plants. So Seth, what are we doing now?
All right, well, we've got a wide variety of plants here, and you can cover crop with like whatever you want. I mean, I think for me, diversity is key, and you know, also having things that aren't gonna spread disease to your plant are also key. So we've got a few different things here. These are French marigolds. These are one of my favorites. We'll throw a few of these in. Now these seeds are kind of big and they have a great germination rate, so we're not gonna put too many seeds in. Because if you put too many French marigold seeds in, oh yeah, like that, that's too many. If you put too many in, it's just gonna be all French marigold, and they grow really big. So we'll put a little bit of that in. And then I've also got this creeping thyme. The reason I like creeping thyme is because it grows like really low on the soil. And so you want, or at least what I want is like, I want things low to the soil, an inch above the soil, a foot above the soil, 3 feet above the soil. You know, you have like these different canopies.
Different layers. Yeah.
Exactly. So this creeping thyme is gonna be the very bottom layer.
Bottom layer.
Yeah, and that'll just go, it'll just like go right along the soil, and it'll spread too.
Ooh.
Well, maybe a little for the lawn too, that's fine. We've got these pink surprise calendula. It's like a really beautiful variety of calendula. And that's another common IPM plant, you know, like Steve Cantwell uses the French marigold and the dichondra. A lot of people will use the calendula, which also is, you know, plays a similar role as the French marigold. And then, like I was just saying, the dichondra, that's this. It's like a very low-lying ground cover crop that kind of has like a shoot that looks a little bit like a clover. So we'll put a little bit of that in.
Those look like treated seeds, man.
Yeah, these are treated seeds, but I don't really care. And then this is the Teal Farm arugula wasabi. So this is the arugula wasabi seed that I collected from my flowering arugula wasabi plants. So I call it the Teal Farm version, but it's just normal arugula wasabi seeds. And the reason I like these is because they grow really beautifully and the plant tastes good. So if I'm ever just perusing my cover crop, I can grab a snack, my favorite. And then there's the mountain lupin or lupin. This is, you know, one of the most beautiful plants in the world, in my opinion. We'll just put a few of these seeds in here. That's plenty. And the reason I like the lupin is because it grows these beautiful flowers that, you know, they can be up to like a foot tall, maybe even taller. And so, you know, it's nice to have that variety, like I was saying. And then last but certainly not least is the native yarrow. So this is the white yarrow millifolia. This is one of my favorite native plants. And this is also just, again, this is another great cover crop seed. So any cover crop seed you decide on, something that works for your climate, something that works for your context, blah, blah, blah. The only other recommendation I would have is to add a few native seeds. I always like having native seeds. And so this is a California native mix. It has a lot of poppy. It also has some lupin. So, you know, we're gonna have a variety of lupin in here, and it's got a few other ones. So we're going maximum diversity, and you don't really need that much. See how this is taking up just a very small fraction of this container. So here, come get a close up on this. We've mixed it up.
So Seth, what's the ideal time to cover crop? Should they plant their cannabis little babies and then cover crop immediately? And why are you waiting until what, right before flower on these guys?
The reason that there's no cover crop in there now is because I was like waiting for these cannabis plants to grow up because I don't want them competing for light. I just want them having that relationship with these other plants. You know, like every plant sends down unique exudates and stuff. And so right now we're going into flower. I'm just like giving it some variety of root exudates, I guess, but.
So we're like literally more sugars, because that's what root exudates, I mean, one of the things that root exudates are sugar, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
So this is a natural way to feed sugars to your plants once they start to go or a little bit before flower.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm not gonna be too precious about this. I'm just gonna start chucking these seeds, and I'm not gonna spill it. I'm just gonna start chucking these seeds all over the place over here. And if half these seeds die, I wouldn't even care, because that would mean that the other half are successful, you know? So I don't really get too precious about this. I'm just making sure that there's good coverage. And then after this, I might put some straw on top just to make sure that the seeds are covered so that they've got that moisture to be sure that they germinate. And I'm keeping track of where I do this as well. So I've got greens outside here. I think this is bok choy. And so I'm keeping everything kind of segmented off in this side of the garden. So that's good for this side. Now we'll go to the other side and I'll do the same there. But here, follow me around this corner. We'll see that I did a very similar thing right over here about a week and a half ago. And you can already tell after a week and a half of letting them sprout, they're sending their dicotyledons out. And this is what hopefully that peyote Skittles bed will look like in about a week and a half, where these plants are really starting to get going. You can see this is an old lupin here, and some of its new friends are joining it in the plant kingdom, right in the shade of the cannabis plants above it.
All right, Seth, so I know you got a very custom mix for your climate, your garden here, but like say somebody who doesn't want to buy all these things, but they still want to like do a cover crop, what'd be easy so that people don't have to buy like 10 things and then use your wasabi arugula seeds and make a unique mix that, you know, you really like? Because does it really matter what plants they use, or could they, what do they do?
Yeah, well, it definitely does matter what plants they use, but there's a huge variety. And every time I'm on your channel and I'm mixing stuff up, there's never like one single ingredient that's going to make that insane difference. And if there ever is, I'll be sure to point it out. But what I'm going for here is a lot of variety. And what you can do is you can just go on the internet and find like a cover crop seed mix. Let's say you live in Wisconsin. I bet you could go find like native Wisconsin wildflowers, and then you could also find like five seed cover crop blend, and I bet if you blended those two seed blends together, then you'd have the natives plus you'd have that, like, the power of the cover crop. You know, if you're lacking nitrogen, you can do something that fixes nitrogen, like a clover. If you're lacking organic matter, you could do like a tall grass that just brings a lot of like organic matter into your soil and stuff. And so different cover crop mixes will be used for different things. My main thing is I want variety and I want coverage on top of the soil.
Cool. So, I mean, I know like TD uses a cannabis cover crop designed for, you know, growing under cannabis plants or in the off season. Would you recommend that?
Yeah, the Cannasura cover crop.
Yeah, Cannasura, right.
That's exactly. A good one. I have some of that and I like it, but I would use that in the off season. I don't think I would use it while the cannabis is growing, at least not this late in the season, because I think some of those like really big seeded things will compete for the cannabis at a certain point. So that might be an off season cover crop. I'd have to look into it.
I see, sure. So then the other thing I want to point out is that, you know, the flower, some of the flowers like the calendula and the marigolds, those have edible petals. You guys could eat those, as well as a creeping thyme edible, as well as your wasabi arugula edible also. Mm-hmm. So yeah, so you could kind of grow more food, and I'm sure he'll let some of those grow out after the cannabis comes out, and he'll have lots more wasabi arugula and some maybe edible flowers to eat as well.
Exactly.
Cool. So now that you got the cover crop seeded out, now let's find out how you're going to water them in.
Let's do it.
All right, so now Seth's going to water in his plants, but he just doesn't water it any old way. He's going to water it in with compost tea. That is amended compost tea. Very important. I don't even know if I've showed this on my channel before. Amending and making your compost tea even better. He's been brewing some boogie brew in a 5-gallon bucket for about 18 hours now. So he's going to top it off with some additives, and then we'll show you guys how you can easily water it in. So Seth, what are we doing?
Yeah, well, first of all, John, what's that Boogie Brew code they're supposed to use?
You want to check out Boogie Brew at boogiebrew.net/GYG for the hookup price on the Boogie Brew products.
Exactly. So yeah, huge shout out to Boogie Brew. Right now I'm brewing with two bags. I don't know why, but I decided I was going to put it in two separate bags, and then we got the air stones in there. And you know, a lot of people will add sugar at the beginning of their process of brewing the tea, but what I like to do is add it towards the end. So some people add it when you have like an hour left, or maybe you've used half your compost tea and you want it to you know, live for another 24 hours or something. You can add a little bit of sugar, and that will you know, like, give the microbes a little bit more food so that they can you know, they can continue reproducing in your compost tea, and you can extend the life of that. So I'm adding in a few little handfuls of this succinate sugar, which is an excellent source of, you know, carbohydrates for your little microbes that are growing in your compost tea. This is Boogie Bricks. This is a mixture of a few different sugars plus a little bit of maxi crop seaweed kelp thing, which is, you know,
another basically sugar or polysaccharide you should also be feeding your compost tea, in my opinion. I mean, in some levels, feeding kelp is actually even more important than feeding sugar. It's like a long-term, like, slowly digested sugar, if you want to put it that way.
Totally. And then a little bit of molasses. Not too much, you know, and I just like a variety of sugars, but any old sugar is probably just fine. You know, I like to stick to organic, but either way. Then there's also some of this Boogie Black. This will, you know, infuse the tea with some black soldier fly larva castings and frass. And the reason I love this is because not only does it help the plant stay strong, but it will also, you know, help the plant stay resistant to diseases. A lot of insects and predatory things will just smell the black soldier fly larva frass, and they won't even come near your plants, which I love. You know, what do they say? Like, an ounce of prevention is better than a
pound of cure.
Pound of cure, that's the one. All right, and then we're getting towards the end here, but this is the Rootwise Biofoss. So this is a biological bloom support. This is my first year using any Rootwise products, but they've been highly recommended to me, and so far so good on these. I think this stuff a little goes a long way, so I'm just going to put a little dab of this Rootwise Biofoss bloom support in here. Now again, no affiliations with this company, but I saw them use it on Build-A-Soil, and I thought, hey, why not? I'll give it a try. And last but not least is the wetting agent. We talked about this last time you interviewed me, John, but the wetting agent, it just helps your soil get even more wet. It's like making water wetter.
Like a yucca, right?
I'm not sure if this one is a yucca, but this one is made from, I don't know, canola oil and potassium hydroxide. I don't even know what that is. Anyways, that will make it so that there aren't going to be anaerobic pockets and pockets that are really dry. It'll even out the moisture throughout your garden bed. So what I'm going to do
is I'll just stir the rest of that in, avoiding the giant bags of compost tea that I have in here. And it's changed the color a little bit. This is looking good. And now some people will use like an ortho sprayer, or they'll put it in like a little hand watering thing like this. But I find that that's not really the best way to get an even coat on my soil. So what I like to do is I've got this siphon here. And this siphon, as you'll see, is directly connected to my hose, like you showed on the first episode here. So we'll just drop that siphon in, make sure it's towards the bottom because we want to be getting as much of that stuff as we can. And then here, we'll go pick up this hose. And you'll hear it. You'll hear it in the siphon when it works. You hear that sound? The siphon is trembling. You can like, John, you want to feel it? It's like vibrating kind of.
Oh yeah, you feel it sucking in there and it's going in.
Exactly. So you can feel the water being sucked up through that tube, and it takes a little bit for it to get all the way through the hose, but sometimes you can actually see the color of the water change as the material is being siphoned up into it.
Okay. I mean, no, it's coming out darker. Oh, yeah. Look at that.
All right, so yeah, now
it's not clear. You can see it's kind of a little bit dirty.
Now you can see the water is not perfectly clear anymore. And so that way we know that the compost tea is coming through the hose. So I'll just take this hose and I will do a nice light watering. I don't think these plants need a ton today. And because this is diluted, I don't really have to worry about overfeeding that compost tea. Not that, you know, it's pretty hard to overfeed compost tea, but I'm diluting it even further, so it should be totally all right. And we'll just go make sure that these cover crops are getting the water they need. So yeah, we just threw the seed on here, and we know young seedlings need a little bit of, water to break that seed head off of there and to get them germinating. So yeah, hopefully, John, next time you come, we'll have a beautiful stand of some flowers and some other cover crops under these peyote skittles. And yeah, we can have a GYG mix take credit for the cover crop under this. So anyway, yeah. That's how we do it.
All right, so now we're here with Super Seth for the fifth interview in his garden with his garden update. So Seth, how's it been going the last few weeks? What you been up to?
Well, time flies. I can't believe it's already garden update 15. Things are finally getting out of veg and getting into flower. I've been making sure that, you know, all the plants are looking good. Observing kind of like those early hairs on what will be the buds soon. And then also I just trellis netted the peyote skittles, which I've never used a trellis net when growing before. Usually I just like set things up with bamboo stakes and stuff. So that's something that's new to me and new to the garden since the last time you were here. Other than that, I did a bit of a defoliation again because I hadn't like finished it last time you were here. And then, what else? Yeah, I mean, this compost tea application is gonna be, the next sort of big fertilization or whatever you would call it. But I've just been keeping up on watering. I find that the edges of the bed really get super dry and the interior of the bed just stays completely soaked. And so most of the time what I've been doing is just watering the outside of the bed, like just along the edge. That's been my tip as it gets hot. And, you know, I expect the soil to be dry and then it's not.
Yep, cool. So, Seth, how many hours in a day do you spend in the garden is the question. Because I know a lot of you, I mean, I know you work from home like I do. But a lot of people may have to go to work every day. So like, yeah, how many hours do you spend and what do you do?
Yeah, like what do I do professionally?
No, what do you do in the garden for the hours you spend in the garden every day?
Yeah, that's a good question. I would say it depends on the day a lot, but I like to be out in the garden as much as I can. I mean, on an average day, maybe like 2 or 3 hours, but if it's like a busy weekend or maybe GYG is coming the next day, maybe I'll spend like 6 or 7 hours in the garden or something.
So this is like horse and pony show.
Yeah. I just wanted to look in tip-top shape before we press record. But yeah, what I'm really saying is like, I guess on like a busy day when I'm working from home, I might spend way less than an hour. On like a not busy day working from home, I could spend 4 hours in the garden. But when I'm in the garden, a lot of what I'm doing is just like observing my plants and seeing how they're growing and doing like defoliation. And, you know, I do that super cropping during veg. I'm always super cropping. And so, I guess when I'm out in the garden, just like I was saying last episode, the best fertilizer is a garden's shadow. A lot of what I'm doing is just observing, I'm tidying things up. And pulling weeds takes like some time, but really what I'm doing is just like pruning, making sure everything's growing properly.
Right on. Yeah, I mean, I was just in my garden. I think I spent 4 hours like the whole morning just a couple days ago. And I was just like picking figs, finding the right figs, eating them, picking ones off the ground, cutting the bad spots off, eating them, and then pulling like brown leaves and just kind of like just maintenance.
Exactly.
To kind of keep it looking nice instead of all like ragged and wild. I mean, you definitely have a nice manicured garden for sure.
Thanks, man.
All right, so you talked about defoliating a lot. I mean, just in the last few weeks, you're defoliating, and I know you're mulching some of your leaves. Hopefully you're eating or blending or juicing some of the leaves as well to get those nutrients into you because you love the cannabis plant so much. But let's talk about more defoliation. Are you still going to defoliate now that you're actually in a flower?
Yeah, so some people would say that you defoliate as you're going into flower, and then you also defoliate like 21 or 25 days into flower. And that's kind of just like a grower's like rule of thumb. So I would say I'm kind of always defoliating. Like if I walk up to one of my plants and I just like see that like, oh, like that leaf is just totally covering a bud site, I'll just like pluck that leaf off. And like, I don't do it on any schedule, but then I will go through phases where I'm like, whoa, oh my God, I haven't defoliated in so long. And these plants look super bushy. Like, I'm just gonna like pull a bunch of the stuff off. I like to like a third of the plant, like the bottom third of the plant, I take almost all of the vegetative growth off of that. And then, like I was saying a second ago, if there's a leaf that's covering a bud site, those bud sites need to photosynthesize. That's where the plant is gonna put its energy. And so you wanna remove those leaves that are covering bud sites. So I would say, you know, if you're new to this, then maybe plan on doing a defoliation right as you flip into flower, and then another defoliation maybe 25 days later, and that's a pretty good defoliation schedule.
So if somebody defoliates versus not, what's the difference they're gonna see?
Well, what I see is that it will increase the vigor of the plant. So when I defoliate during veg, I see, like, I pull those leaves off, and then the plant goes crazy, producing new leaves, new shoots. It'll get, you know, wider and taller as a plant. The other thing that people say that defoliation is good for is airflow around the plant. So a lot of cannabis strains are very susceptible to powdery mildew and whatever other mildews might grow in your area. And so if you increase the airflow that's able to get, especially the older, lower stuff, stuff that might get splashed on by your hose and stuff, because like moisture is really what makes those mildews grow and stuff. And so if you defoliate the lowers and you allow more airflow, you're much less likely to run into things like powdery mildew.
Cool. So talking about powdery mildew and other pests, before you get into flower, I know recently you also did an IPM treatment. So you mm-hmm. want to talk about what you did and why?
Yeah, so I don't do it on any sort of schedule. I mean, I know some people say like tea Tuesdays, foliar Fridays, IPM Sundays, and things like that. And I think those are all great rules of thumb, but I'm, like Josh says, I'm more of a field-based farmer. And what I do is like, if I wake up really early in the morning on just like some random day, I will make my own little IPM spray. So what I like to use is the thyme oil, like thyme extract oil, because apparently things like bugs don't really like the smell of it. And so it'll drive them away. And then there's also like these garlic extracts that do a similar thing. So your plants might smell like garlic for a little bit, but that's not the worst thing in the world. Another thing that people do is like this thing called Thuricide or BT, also known as Bacillus thuringiensis, which will kill your caterpillars. Caterpillars love to eat cannabis, and they will actually live inside of the buds and eat the inside of the bud, totally unbeknownst to the grower. So BT is super important in your IPM sprays. So yeah, basically what I do is I'll pour whatever combination of things I think I need to pour into my Chapin sprayer, and then I'll just load that up and spray the plants early in the morning. And hopefully that drives away pests, hopefully it drives away powdery mildew, hopefully I can avoid bud rot and things like that.
So how soon before flower do you do that? Or do you do it in flower?
I would do it early in flower, but not mid to late in flower. So I think if you're, you know, maybe a week or two into flower, you can probably get away with it. Definitely, I would say Google it, check with your strain, check to see what its IPM needs are. You know, for instance, a strain like Runtz is very low probability that it would get powdery mildew because it's sort of like, it's known for resisting powdery mildew. Then there are other plants that are known like, oh, the caterpillars might not like this plant. So look at your specific cultivar of what you're growing and be like, what is a good IPM regimen for this exact plant?
All right, Seth, so another question I have for you is I want to talk about feeding, since you're growing all organically. Like if you're using conventional nutrients or deadrients, like Josh would like to say, You put those on the plant, they're water soluble, they go right in the plant, and the plant can more immediately respond. So when you're doing organic style feeding, you can't just put most things directly in and it just goes right up. So you want to talk about like front loading your feeding when using organics.
Yeah, so you know, if I understand correctly, it takes time for these microbes and all of the soil life to break all of these fertilizers down and turn them into bioavailable nutrients for your plant, right? And so what I like to do is I do what I call front loading nutrients. I think a lot of people call it that. And basically what you're doing is you're giving that nutrients a little bit earlier in the growth phase from when it actually needs it, because there is like kind of a long fuse on that.
A delay.
Yeah, exactly. So you could imagine like if you put a little bit of bloom fertilizer and it's organic, if you put a little bit of that in your soil, it's not like that very same day that bloom fertilizer is being uptaken by your plants. You know, it needs to get integrated into the soil, and then a worm needs to eat it and poop it out, and then a microbe maybe eats it, and then, you know, it sort of is all part of this web of life. And so, you know, when you were here last, we did like that flowering top dress, but these plants weren't really even in flower at that point. But the reason we did it then is because maybe it takes 2, 3, or 4 weeks for all this stuff to be breaking down. And so while these plants are in flower, they're actually enjoying that stuff. And by that same token, I wouldn't really add any amendments in like the last few weeks of flowering and the last few weeks of the plant's life, because you're basically feeding it nothing, because that stuff won't really have broken down by the time your plants are ready to uptake it.
But it's good for your next season.
Yeah. That's planning way in advance. But yeah, I like that.
All right, Seth, so next let's talk about cannabis clubs, one place you like to avoid. I don't like to go in there too much either, because then you get like lumped in like you're a stoner or you're, you know, whatever. I love cannabis and, you know, I love eating it, and I don't smoke it. But let's talk about cannabis clubs and like how you believe every cannabis club smells the same. And, you know, to think about it, like I've been into cannabis clubs and they like kind of have the same, I don't want to say dank smell.
It is though. That's kind of what it is.
Or if you go into every McDonald's, like McDonald's, all the restaurants always smell the same, right? But every time I visit somebody's garden that's growing cannabis, it always smells different.
Yeah, exactly.
So you want to discuss this?
Sure, yeah. I mean, I've been, the last 3 episodes, including this one, I've been totally beating up on clubs and stuff. And like, there are some good cannabis clubs. But the bottom line is like, could you imagine a world where every restaurant smelled the same? Or could you imagine a world where all the food in the restaurant was the exact same? So whether you're at the nicest restaurant in the world or the most boring, lame restaurant in the world, it smells the same and it tastes the same. And I feel a little bit of that with cannabis clubs because, you know, like I've said in the past, if you're using the same genetics and the same nutrients, no matter if you're at the very southern end of California or the very northern end
of California. And you're indoors and controlling the environment. I mean, you're exactly getting the same exact thing every single time, like the low quality. It's like going to McDonald's.
Exactly.
You got the same thing in France or in America. They got the same ass hamburgers that taste the same.
Yeah.
And some people like that.
Sure.
But I like variety.
Exactly. So yeah, there's like a homogenized consistency to cannabis clubs, which is like, I guess that works for some people. But to me, that is like super boring. And there are so many ways you can like just make this plant so different and make it smell so different and taste so different. And like, I don't know, they don't seem to get the memo. And you know, tell me there's a huge difference between cannabis clubs. Like, I don't really see the variety. It's basically like a bunch of eighths of ounces just sitting on a shelf, and it's like, pick your poison. Whether it's low quality or high quality, it's gonna smell very similar, and it's gonna taste similar and give you similar effects. It's just not very exciting.
But here's the thing, Seth. I mean, there are cannabis users, and then there are cannabis abusers, and then there's cannabis connoisseurs.
Yes.
So, you know, I kind of put you more in the connoisseur class, but just the cannabis,
all 3.
A cannabis user just wants to get high or get the intoxicating effect. Do they really give a shit how it makes them feel or what they're smoking?
Yeah, you know, maybe they think that they are pleased with their product because they've only seen this narrow
they've never had better
gene pool. Yeah, it'd be like, oh, you've only ever had McDonald's in your life. Wait till you try real food. You know what I mean? So some of these people are totally satisfied with the boring genetics and the boring everything else, and that's fine for them. I hope they're happy, but you know, it is possible that they could expand their horizons and, you know, experience more of this plant, because this plant does have a lot of variety to offer and it is very segmented right now.
So, well, I will say a lot of the stuff at cannabis clubs are just grown, you know, basically hydroponically with chemical nutrients that I wouldn't want you guys to put into your body. There are maybe few companies that are growing cannabis right, and they may be available near you, growing beyond organic and doing the processes that like Seth is doing to have living soil. So Seth, how would somebody differentiate between the different products at the clubs? Because the clubs don't seem to differentiate that a lot. They just lump everything. This is just what we got.
And yeah.
They go by the THC percentage or the strain.
Yeah.
Or the, you know, the type, sativa or indica.
Yeah, I would say, you know, there's just like there are bartenders at the bar, there's bud tenders at these bud shops. And when you talk to the bud tender, be like, hey, I'm actually interested in maybe something that was grown in living soil or something that was grown under the sun, you know, because you'll get different plant terpenes when the sun is putting all those UV rays and things that LED lights that are mostly used in grows don't have. So you can ask your bud tender, I want something unique. Maybe I want something that has a little bit of CBD in it. Maybe be like, oh, are there any new genetics that, you know, who's coming back and saying, oh my God, I loved this one plant and like, it's totally different than something else I've tried. So, you know, if you're in Nevada like you are, you can look for something like Green Life Productions. They make excellent cannabis. I've never tried it, but I just know for a fact that it's great because everyone loves Steve Cantwell. And then if you're around here, there's a company called Moon Valley Cannabis, and they grow living soil organic cannabis indoors under LEDs. So they're doing like kind of a hybrid of what I'm doing, but it's indoors, and they grow some super high quality stuff. They're also interested in unique genetics and stuff. And so maybe there are people in your area that are, you know, creating unique strains or unique buds, but you know, you might have to ask your bud tender and get the lowdown.
Of course, better than that is, I say, grow your own if it is legal to do so. Like in the state of California, you can grow your own plants depending on what state you are in and if it is legalized or not. Some states will allow you if it's recreationally legal to grow. Other states, if it's recreationally legal, they will not allow you unless maybe you have a medical card, and then otherwise your laws may vary. So check your laws. But that's why I have these videos to share with you guys how you guys could, you know, grow unlimited different kinds of varieties in many different ways at your house by using some of the techniques that Seth shared with you. And of course, you know, like Seth is to cannabis like I am to vegetables. You go to the store, man, you got like, oh, there's like 100 different vegetables there. But man, if you get a Baker Creek heirloom seed catalog, man, there's like 5,000 different kinds of vegetables you can grow and buy. Like, and it's all insane. It's going to boggle your mind, man. So like, I want you guys to diversify your cannabis types and grow more CBD dominant strains with more different kinds and a different spread of cannabinoids, and also grow a lots of different kind of weird ass vegetables, which is what I love. So Seth, one of the last questions I have for you is I like to ask you every single time, like, who have you been following? What's been you, getting you interested in, on YouTube, like other YouTube channels or books or authors that you're really, you know, following that you think my viewers should look into?
Yeah, so for this installment of Super Seth's monthly media mentions, I would say I've been out here, and John is giving me a hard time about the amount of time I spend in my garden, but I'm also listening to audiobooks while I'm out here. So in those countless hours that I'm out here enjoying my garden, I'm also listening to audiobooks about the garden. And so one author that I really love is Michael Pollan. He has this book called Botany of Desire, where he goes through this sort of like human plant relationship of these four very unique plants. One of those plants being cannabis, another is tomatoes, tulips, and apples, if I recall correctly. And so he like goes through the human plant relationship that these plants have had for like throughout history. And it's just, it's a beautiful book. And like his big hit book is The Omnivore's Dilemma, which is also a great book. But like Botany of Desire, if you're a backyard gardener, it is like, it's like chicken soup for the backyard gardener's soul. It's like the best backyard gardener book I could ever imagine. So I love Michael Pollan and that book, Botany of Desire. Another one is The Third Plate by Dan Barber. And that is a book where he like travels the world looking for like the highest quality food and how are those farmers actually creating that food. And so, you know, like he sort of like contrasts the factory farmer to the artisan farmer, and like he goes to Spain, and there's this like acres and acres and acres of like all these different interconnecting species, and little you know, it's like a farm. And so like it looks like maybe it's just an aquatic area, but then it turns out you can, you know, it's like the highest quality fish, and then on the shore is like a very high quality vegetable and all this stuff. So definitely check out The Third Plate by Dan Barber. And then the last book I will recommend is The Intelligent Gardener by Steve Solomon. And that is like, it's more of like a technical book, but it's a really, really, really good, like practical knowledge book all about like just how to improve your gardening skills and how to kind of understand everything you're doing to your garden. Like when you're adding these amendments, what's actually happening, and you know, how do you measure these things and all this stuff. So if you want to get like a little more technical, I would check out The Intelligent Gardener by Steve Solomon. And then, so maybe some people aren't interested in books and you're, you know, maybe you're just watching a YouTube video like I do so often. And so some other people to check out on YouTube for growing cannabis, there's this guy named Mr. Canucks Grow. He's a Canadian dude who grows indoors. But what I really like about him is he'll bring you start to finish in one video. So he'll start with a seed, and then by the end of the video, he's got the product. And he also shows things like how to make hash, and he does a little more in-depth things like how to defoliate. And he's got many, many videos. He's a super popular cannabis grower on YouTube. So I'd recommend him. Last but certainly not least, there's this guy named Brandon. His name is Brandon Rust, like R-U-S-T. And his Instagram handle is Rust Brandon. And he is gonna be on that podcast First Smoke of the Day soon. And he's like this really, really, really interesting grower who started a company called Bokashi Earthworks. And he has got to be one of the most knowledgeable living soil growers in the world. I mean, the way he talks about stuff, it's like something that is super complicated to me is like the back of his hand for him. He's like so intense about growing like perfect plants. He lives out in Oklahoma. He's doing acres and acres and acres of cannabis. And he's always like, you know, he's getting interviewed by people and giving out these pro tips. So yeah, if you want a super pro tip, way beyond what I'm doing in living soil, this guy Rust Brandon, or Brandon Rust, is super worth checking out.
All right, cool, right on. All right, Seth, so the last question I have for you is, what words of wisdom would you like to share with my viewers this time around?
Well, let's see. I would say diversity is key. And so you saw the way we were making that cover crop seed blend, I was just like, oh man, I want all these various seeds. And then when we went and put the sugar in the compost tea, I was like, oh dude, I'll put like three different sugars in here. And the reason I do that is because like the more diversity you have, the more unique your plants are going to end up being. And so like just turn that diversity dial up to 11, you know, just like, oh, you've got 12 different types of sugar, well,
let's add 13.
Yeah. Exactly. Like why not just like see what happens when you increase the diversity. And maybe you've got to learn a lesson the hard way, like maybe something takes over your plant or something. But you know, like I don't know, for me diversity is just like, it's a super important part of the garden, and it's kind of what makes it unique, you know.
No, I completely agree. Diversity with your garden, feeding your garden, because every different bacteria likes different kinds of foods or sugars or whatever. Different kinds of plants put out different root exudates. But then let's kind of pivot that and think about us. I want you guys to eat a diverse diet. I mean, it's shown in published studies that, you know, eating at least minimum 30 different types of plant foods a week is going to encourage your microbiome to be more diverse in your gut. That's going to help you digest more your food better and have a better diversity, so you can have better health, right? How many of you guys go to the grocery store every week and buy the same thing week in and week out and eat those same foods? I mean, that's what you're doing when you're feeding your cannabis plants chemicals. You're feeding them the same thing day in and day out, and Seth's trying to do the opposite, spin it on its head and just eat all kinds of, or feed his plants all different kinds of things, right? And that's what I'm trying to do for me, and I want you guys to do that for you in your diets as well. So next time you go to the grocery store, pick out some seeds to buy. Buy something that you never grew before, especially I'm really into some of the purple plants, you know, with the anthocyanin content. You know, get into different roots and tubers to eat, different starch tubers. You know, diversify your diet and you'll be healthier, and diversify your garden so your plants could be healthier too. All right, Seth, so this was an excellent episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode at Super Seth this time, be sure to give this video a big thumbs up. More importantly, share this with other cannabis growers so that they can learn how to have some of the techniques and tips for having living soil and producing bountiful harvests in their garden as well. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss my new and upcoming episodes. I'll be coming out every 5 to 7 days. You're never know or show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bells to get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. Past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,700 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teach you guys how to grow your own food, vegetables, fruits, and herbs at home. Also, links down below to my past episodes with Super Seth so you guys can get all the updates. if you guys just found this video and not the others, you guys can see the full growing season. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.